Okay. Welcome to our virtual open house. I'm Father Michael Tidd, headmaster of Delbarton School. While regretfully we can't offer you an in-person open house experience this year, we hope that you enjoyed that quick campus flyover video that highlights the breadth and beauty of Delbarton's 187-acre campus. Before our live program begins tonight, we'd also like to offer you essentially a free sample of a year in the life of Delbarton. The following video shows you our favorite pictures from 2019-2020. I think you'll quickly see that, despite a global pandemic, Delbarton managed to deliver its trademark, dynamic, and powerfully transformative educational experience to our students and our families. Please stay tuned for our live virtual open house after this brief video, and thank you for joining us tonight.
On myself, pick up, dust them off, put them back up on the shelf. Just a little baby girl is in need. Am I coming out of left field? Ooh, I'm a rebel just for kicks. I've been feeling it since 1966. Might be over now, but I feel it still. Ooh, I'm a rebel just for kicks. Let me kick it like it's 1986. I'll be over now, but I feel it still. Got another mouth to feed. Leave it with the babysitter, mama call the grave digger. Gone with the falling leaves. Am I coming out of left field? Ooh, I'm a rebel just for kicks now. I've been feeling it since 1966 now.
Welcome, everyone. Once again, I'm Father Michael Tidd. I'm the headmaster here at Delbarton, and we're very excited to have you join our very first virtual open house. The flyover video that you saw right at the beginning before the photo montage showed you a lot about what Delbarton has: beautiful campus, superb facilities, and what Delbarton does, our academic programs, athletics, just to name a few. What I'd like to do in my time with you this evening at the beginning of our program is to tell you what Delbarton is, who we are, our identity and mission, and why we think you should consider us as the place for your son's high school education. Anyone who wants to learn whether Delbarton is the right school for a young man needs to have that sense of our identity and mission. And first and foremost, Delbarton is a Catholic school for young men. We are not apologetic about our Catholic faith, but we are not arrogant about it either. We welcome students and families of any religious faith tradition to join our community should they wish to embrace our school's Catholic values and spirit. But we're not just a generic Catholic school. We're not a Catholic school that's very much like many, many others. We're a very special kind of Catholic school. Delbarton is a Benedictine Catholic school. And what does that mean? Well, the monks of St. Mary's Abbey, the community of which I am a member, live the Christian life according to the way of the rule for monks that St. Benedict of Nursia composed over 1,500 years ago. We draw on a 1,500-year tradition of the Catholic liberal arts that animates schools that are sponsored or operated by Benedictine monastic communities of men and women around the world, quite a few of them here in the United States. We began on this beautiful campus in 1939, and the Benedictines of St. Mary's Abbey have lived on this property since 1927. So monks have been here in Morris County for almost 100 years. So what does exactly it mean for Delbarton to be a Benedictine Catholic school? Well, to understand that, we need to look at two books. The first, the Gospels, and secondly, St. Benedict's Rule for Monks. In his rule in chapter 58, St. Benedict has a chapter titled On the Manner of Receiving Brothers. And it's where he describes how someone who is interested in following the monastic life, how that person is to be received into the community, particularly at the end of his probationary period, when he makes a commitment of stability, committing to this particular place and these particular people, obedience to his abbot and to the rule, and a vow of conversatio morum. And that last phrase is kind of difficult to translate into English. It's often rendered conversion of manners, or more loosely, conversion of life. The entire life of a monk, or anyone who aspires to follow Christ in the Benedictine tradition, is really about just that, a process of conversion, a turning away from the old man of sin and selfishness into the new man who imitates Christ and learns to love God freely and joyfully. And if one's monastic life is lived well, Benedict teaches, one is transformed utterly by living this monastic version of the way of following Jesus Christ. And so for a Benedictine school, for young people who come to be educated in a Benedictine school, a school like Delbarton should also be a place of profound and thoroughgoing transformation, where a young man is known, is loved, and is called to greatness. So let's consider how that happens here at Delbarton. We believe very strongly that Delbarton is a transformative place for a young man. First and foremost, that transformation is spiritual. Delbarton is a school where, in a Catholic community of joy and mutual respect and self-giving for all members of the community, students learn who they really are and what they are called to be as children of God. Delbarton is where a boy's faith becomes that of a man, a mature, free embrace of his relationship with God, whatever his religious faith may be. Secondly, Delbarton is a place of intellectual transformation. Delbarton is a school where students develop critical adult intelligence. Our students learn to create as well as to consume knowledge, to discern the true, the good, and the beautiful in the modern marketplace of ideas, and to express their learning clearly and persuasively, both orally and in writing. Thirdly, Delbarton is a school of physical transformation. It's not simply a matter of getting taller, but Delbarton is a school where students learn and embrace a balanced life of activity and leisure. Our students build a life animated by a healthy development of body as well as of mind and spirit. And then finally, we are a school of emotional transformation. At Delbarton, students learn to identify and embrace their inner emotional lives. They learn that their feelings are a source of critical wisdom about themselves and about others, and they should adopt as their own a fundamentally empathic stance towards all whom they encounter. For in others, as St. Benedict's rule teaches us, they encounter Christ. As we like to say it here at Del Barton, it's about turning away from self and learning to put the other guy first. Such a vision of Del Barton as a transformative place for a young man is deeply rooted in our Catholic and Benedictine identity and mission. Yet it is welcoming to those of all faiths who see its value and choose to contribute to it. This vision of Del Barton fires the good zeal, to use another Benedictine term, of our faculty and staff to create an environment at Del Barton that can realize this vision for each young man among us. Such a vision of Del Barton aims to make real the bond of brotherhood that brings us here tonight, and that we want to pass on to our younger brothers among the student body as they come to join us. Such an ambitious vision of Del Barton is one that is sufficiently ambitious to be worth the investment families make in sending their sons here. We believe that this is a vision eminently worth your consideration, and we're very glad that you've come to our open house to learn in more detail how this transformation happens and to talk to the real people who experience it, as well as those who make it happen. So thanks for your being a part of our program tonight. And now I'm going to turn you over to Dr. David Donovan, our Dean of Admissions and Director of Financial Aid. Dave, take it away.
Thank you, Father Michael. It's so great to have everybody here on hand. I want to extend a very warm welcome to all of our guests and our open house attendees this evening. There are expected to be between 500 and 1,000 of you at this inaugural Del Barton admission event, our first ever virtual open house. So thank you for taking the time and spending a Sunday evening with us in what we hope will be an informative, valuable, and perhaps, as Father Michael alluded to, a transformational experience as you get to learn what we're about and what we do. By way of introduction, my name is David Donovan. I'm the Dean of Admission and Director of Financial Aid at Del Barton School. I've been here since 1991. My wife and I met through a Del Barton connection. I have five children, four of whom attended Del Barton or currently attend Del Barton. We say here we belong. It's certainly been my experience as well. I am deeply invested in this place like all of us are. I can't tell you how incredibly excited I am to introduce to you our panel. The best way to get to know about who we are at Del Barton is to hear from those who are at Del Barton. And we have three people we want you to hear from this evening. We have a middle schooler, Zeke Ehrenberg, who you're going to hear from in a moment. He will give the view from below, as it were. He is our seventh and eighth grade representative. We have Matt Johnson, who is our upper school student, and you'll hear from him. And he is actually a lifer. He started in seventh grade, and he is now a senior. And then finally, you'll hear from a parent, specifically Erin Manahan, a mom. You'll get the female perspective on what it's like to be at Del Barton. She is married to and has raised Del Barton alums. So she too, like me, is deeply vested in this place. So without further ado, let's begin our live panel, and we'll begin with Zeke Ehrenberg. Zeke, take it away.
Thank you, Dr. Donovan. Good evening, everyone. My name is Ezekiel Ehrenberg, and I'm an eighth grader here at Del Barton. There are so many wonderful aspects to Del Barton, and I want to talk about a few that mean the most to me. First is the brotherhood. The brotherhood is my favorite thing about Del Barton. You feel it literally everywhere. In the classroom, at sporting events, on community service projects, during drama productions, and of course, at Mass. And as one of the 76 middle schoolers, I never feel alone, especially because our upper school brothers look after us, from advising us in the middle school mentors program to giving us rides to off-campus events. Even during this COVID pandemic, there was real bonding among the students, which kept our spirits high and our lives moving forward. We came up with creative ways to learn and bond while not being together. For instance, we had Zoom movie nights, remote science fairs, online gaming competitions, and virtual community service projects. Being a Del Barton middle schooler this past year has been great. I am what we call a lifer, which sounds like it's a jail sentence, but it just means you're a Del Barton brother for life. This means my friends at Del Barton are my family away from home. They have my back and they trust me with theirs. Now on to teachers. I really love my teachers here at Dalbarton. They expect the best from us because they know and care about each student individually. If I want to talk with a teacher, with Mr. Cimino, our middle school guidance counselor, or with Mr. Stoll, our middle school moderator, they are always there and ready to help. They believe in us, and this makes us believe in ourselves and push harder to reach our full potential. My confidence has really grown since I came to Dalbarton. I actually feel like a completely different person now. I'm not afraid to ask for help. The teachers explain things really well too and make sure I understand what I need to know. They care about us and are great at what they do. The whole Dalbarton middle school experience pushes us, challenges us, and prepares us to become successful high school students and beyond. Exceptional students and exceptional opportunities. The students here are so different and so talented. Being around them makes you raise your own game. In just the last year, I've become interested in subjects like debate and economics, foreign language, and science. Before I came to Dalbarton, I never knew that I'd enjoy these subjects or that I'd be any good at them. Now here I am, a middle school national debate finalist who's had the opportunity to debate at Harvard and the University of Pennsylvania. I'm also learning French, analyzing stock market data, and playing football and hockey. But this isn't just me. My Dalbarton brothers are just as curious and talented in academics, sports, and the arts. And I'm inspired by them every single day. Students like this and opportunities like these make Dalbarton a really fun place to go to school. The campus here is beautiful. When you walk around Dalbarton's 200 acres and look at the old architecture, the Italian statues, the formal garden, and the ponds, you feel like you're connected to something important and meaningful. Dalbarton's campus inspires you to learn and to do big things. I am very lucky to be here. Now let me take a second to talk about Ben. Who's Ben? Ben's our amazing school dog. A 100-pound Mastiff and Black Lab mix. A gentle giant who roams the halls, welcomes visitors, and looks for unguarded breakfast sandwiches. When you see him coming to say hello, you can't help but smile and be reminded of how great things are at Dalbarton. In closing, Dalbarton is a very special home, and I am so grateful to my parents for allowing me to be a student here. It's an incredible setting for young men to learn and grow. And it's a place where everyone belongs. Thank you to Dr. Donovan for allowing me to speak to you tonight. I'll be available to answer live questions at the Q&A section of the program starting at 7 o'clock. Thank you for your time. I hope you enjoy the rest of the virtual open house. Now it's my privilege to introduce to you one of our phenomenal upperclassmen, Matt Johnson. Take it away, Matt.
Thanks, Zeke. Good evening, everyone. My name is Matthew Johnson, and I'm from Somerset, New Jersey, about 35 minutes away from Dalbarton. I have two younger brothers, Ryan, who's a current junior, and Andrew, who's a current eighth grader. I was in the same position as you're in right now, just 6 years ago. My Dalbarton experience since that has been nothing short of phenomenal. When I entered high school in September of 2018, my class grew from 36 students to 136 students, with kids from 12 counties and 120 towns across New Jersey. This can definitely seem daunting at first here, but at Dalbarton, everyone belongs. Here, students want to help each other succeed in the classroom. It is definitely common to see students collaborate and study in small groups and to prepare for quizzes and tests and tackle challenges together. Dalbarton also has many student support resources like peer-to-peer tutoring programs such as the Writing Center, Math Tutoring Center, and Foreign Languages peer-to-peer programs. I have definitely become a better writer, speaker, and a better student over my time at Dalbarton. There are an incredible array of extracurricular activities at Dalbarton, which is super exciting. There are 41 athletic teams, 23 campus ministry service projects, 32 student club activities, and many more. As a late Dalbarton teacher, coach, and mentor said, Brian Fleury, if you're going to get wet, get soaked. Dalbarton breeds a multifaceted kid young men who are encouraged to leave their comfort zones, get wet, and start living and forming leadership skills. I have friends, for instance, who are three-sport varsity athletes, accomplished actors and musicians, nationally recognized forensic debaters, coordinators of our very many community service projects, product designers and entrepreneurs, and governor's school and national merit scholars. At Del Barton, it's definitely cool to do smart and many other things. As for me, I'm a varsity lacrosse player, and I can't wait to take the field in the spring, especially given our circumstances due to the coronavirus last year. Our run to the TOC final in 2019, the electric atmosphere and the opportunity to compete for the Green Wave will be some of my most fond lifelong memories from Del Barton. There's nothing like playing in front or standing in the middle of our fan pit and experiencing the pride and spirit of this remarkable place. I'm also on the Council of Seniors, helping run school-wide events with 11 other council members across six grades. There's always something exciting happening on campus. This upcoming week, we have a very fun pep rally plan. In November, we're gonna have our annual Thanksgiving food drive in which we collect 75,000 pounds of food, which supplies a Morristown food bank for over a year. And in December, we have our annual Christmas toy drive, in which we give toys and provide toys to underprivileged children in Paterson, New Jersey, and all of the elaborate decorations to really bring the Christmas spirit to life on campus. The spring sees our largest number of events, especially the Poetry Out Loud contest and our student written and directed one act plays. Basically, there's no shortage of things to do, and Del Barton is a very exciting place. Finally, I'm also part of Diversity Amongst Peers program and help organize social and educational events to increase cultural awareness and diversity at Del Barton. Many don't know that 24% of the Del Barton body self-identifies as non-white, but more importantly, we are able to share our diverse backgrounds, faiths, and experiences within a common culture of brotherhood. 2 weeks ago, for instance, we had our Hispanic Heritage Month celebration, which featured a Copa America soccer tournament, food from many different Hispanic countries, live music, and it was great. We also have a Black History Month celebration in the spring and programming throughout the year that helps us understand and appreciate our common place under God. The Benedictine Catholic culture of our school guides how we treat each other. Needless to say, there's something for everyone at Del Barton, and you guys can definitely find your place here. Although Del Barton is an all-boys school, we do have many opportunities to interact and socialize with girls. Not only do we network with our sister schools during leadership activities, diversity conferences, music and drama performances, and on the bus to and from school, but there are many social events and semi-formal dances at Del Barton. Traditionally, many girls will come to school functions like homecoming, the Del Barton Coffee House, and athletic events. In fact, the values that Del Barton has instilled in me has truly taught me how to be a gentleman. As you can see, Del Barton is truly a special place and has so much to offer. The Del Barton community has helped me discover who I am today and what I can do with my life. And my teachers and peers have been there through all the challenges and to support me through them. I will be available to answer any questions that you guys may have during the live Q&A session. I hope you guys enjoy the rest of the night and enjoy the rest of the virtual open house. Thank you. Now, moving on to Mrs. Manahan, a Del Barton parent.
Thank you, Matthew. And thank you, Zeke. Real moms need notes, and this is why I'm not the headmaster or Del Barton student, but I will be using notes, Mom. I'm so happy to welcome all of you to Del Barton. My name is Erin Manahan, and I am first the wife of a Del Barton alumni. I am second a Del Barton mom, and now I'm the events director and parent group liaison. Many of you are probably thinking, what in the world could this woman possibly be doing as an events coordinator in the year of 2020? At Del Barton School, I'm doing plenty. With the help of my staff, our beautiful tents, fully masked, of course, and at the direction of my knowledgeable administration, I am pleased to say, while following all the guidelines, this mom has been made safety a top priority, and we have hosted every parent event on our calendar to date. Our Fathers and Friends recently hosted an Oktoberfest for over 50 members. Our Mother's Guild has not missed a beat, which should be no surprise, and has hosted every class coffee and class social. And our Del Barton parents of graduates have been working diligently on spring calendar prospects. I have been a part of this school for over 27 years. I still pretend like I'm 35, so that might give me away. I have never been more proud to be a member of this family. The resilience and dedication to education and this student body has never been more apparent. And for that, I am extremely proud to call myself a staff member. I have worn many green hats over the years. I am married to Jay, as I mentioned earlier, class of 89 alumni. My son, John, is a recent class of 2019 graduate and a current sophomore at Villanova University. I was the Mother's Guild president, and I think Father Michael took me quite literally when I told him they would have to remove me from the senior gardens on graduation day because I just wasn't leaving. He later offered me a job, perhaps to save me from embarrassing myself. At this point, you've seen the gorgeous campus, you've heard about our sports programs, you've watched our talented fine arts at work, and you know about all of our academic successes. What I would like to focus on now, because I'm the mom on the panel, is family and the forever experience of Del Barton. This is a lifelong experience, long after that ceremonial jump in the fountain. I know this, as many of my closest friends are members of the class of 1989. My son's Del Barton friends are the first knock at my door the second he pulls in the driveway, and I happily trip over 14 pairs of shoes every college break. Every one of them is one of his Del Barton friends. I treasure these friendships that my family and I have built. The long green line, you'll hear that referred to a few times, is a phrase we use often. I'm here to tell you it spans far and wide. I know I'm biased, but as a mother, nothing warms my heart more than the polished young men that attend here. At a time when technology rules the world and manners aren't quite as encouraged, I'm happy to say Del Barton continues to make them a top priority. In all of my years here, I am still amazed at our students on a daily basis. I have had boys sprint to hold the door for me, take heavy boxes out of my hands, and have never once said good morning or good afternoon to them first. There is something to be said for these qualities, and as a mother who spent years drilling these points at home, I'm happy to tell you it is demanded here from each and every one of them. Our boys are taught to deliver the firm handshake, look you straight in the eyes, and carry on a conversation better than most grown adults. Lastly, I wanted to reflect today on my experience with my then 11-year-old completing his Del Barton application. Short of chasing him around the kitchen table to say, hurry up and finish your questions, it's never a simple task. For all of you parents out there, in this mess as it is, I cannot imagine. So I'd like you to take a deep breath. Many of you will hear from all the other parents about how their child is writing a better essay than most PhDs, with a cure for every type of cancer included in their answers. Take a deep breath. Allow your child to be themselves and answer these questions on their own. My son spent 90% of the time referencing the chicken tenders he ate while at the Del Barton sports camp and the fact that he could drink soda. Although I explained to him that as an educator, this was not the direction I was planning on going, I acquiesced a little bit just to get a tiny bit of literature and some life experiences beyond food. John began his Del Barton experience as a seventh grader, or as a lifer, as they mentioned, and he ended up leading a very successful academic career regardless of his discussion of the chicken tenders. Our staff will look at your whole child, their mind, their body, and their spirit. And this Del Barton community is made up of every type of child with every talent inside the classroom and outside of our Trinity Hall. Please let your child shine through. They will recognize it. I thank you all for being here. And at this time, I would like to turn the program back over to Dr. Donovan.
Thank you, Zeke, Matt, Erin, for sharing your experiences about Dalbarton. One of the things I love hearing from the students about, I think back to like when I was in middle school, I always feel like I'm going to lose my job when the students speak, because I know for one, I wasn't able to communicate like that. And I want to thank them, especially taking Sunday night to do that. And Erin, I didn't know what Erin was going to say. She's a mom. She's so empathic and so honest in her talk. And I love, Erin, that you said, I'm sure you're listening to me because you were just on, that everybody here is not perfect. You know, Dalbarton is not a place where you have to be. I mean, you're gonna meet high achieving kids, yes, but they're boys nonetheless. And we get boys. We simply understand how they operate. That's kind of our wheelhouse. So please do not be intimidated by us. We are just like you. We just want to be open and honest about who we are. And we hope this program helps you to do that. So in a normal year, we'd be hosting all admission events in person. This is not a normal year, of course. So for everyone's convenience, I just wanted to mention we have a two-track admission process this year, a virtual and an in-person track. The in-person track allows the applicant to test, interview, and take a student-led campus tour in person, led by a student ambassador. We think that's really important, and we love that we can offer that on-campus experience. However, we also offer a virtual track for families, being extremely respectful of the various circumstances people have in these challenging times. If you choose the virtual admission track, this allows applicants to test, interview, and take a virtual campus tour. So we try to be as accommodating as we can to all the different family circumstances. Details about each of these tracks, the in-person and the virtual, are available on our website, dalbarton.org/admissions. Also on our website, you'll be able to enter our brand new UVisit virtual campus tour. We're really, really excited about this, and a lot of work went into it. And it's launching tonight. Basically, it's a fully immersive 360 self-guided tour of our campus and our buildings, where you have hotspots and action zones that come to life and hopefully will give you a sense of our campus, even if you choose or are unable to attend it directly or in person. I encourage you to check it out after the program tonight. Finally, tonight, you'll have an opportunity right now to explore at your own leisure and according to your own particular interests, the many areas of life at Dalbarton. And there are many areas. Basically, we invite you to take the next 30 minutes until about 7 o'clock to experience our virtual open house through our platform, Dalbarton 360. There you will find our on-demand content library. And it's really cool. You get to go into and out of 13 video information booths and explore resources on topic ranging from academics and student life to the admissions process, financial aid, and our transportation program. So we hope you find it very informative. And of course, all of this will be available after the open house indefinitely on our website so you can explore everything even more fully. One note. Please note that the video information booth pertaining to the application process explains the application process in a normal year. However, for details about the process this year, please refer to or consult our two-track admission process, which is on the website and to which I just referred, because this year is an unusual year and you will have two tracks to determine which you want to do. You should have received an email from Dalbarton 360, which includes a link that will take you directly to our virtual open house content. If you did not receive an email, not a problem. You can log in or sign up for Dalbarton 360 at 360.dalbarton.org. That's 360.dalbarton.org, and simply click on the virtual open house link and access that stuff now. We hope you will come back here at 7 o'clock to join us for our live Q&A session. And please enjoy now our video information booths. We'll see you back here at 7. Thanks so much.
Welcome back, everyone. I hope you enjoyed your experience with Del Barton 360, and I'll have a little bit more about that when we finish up our question and answer session. So now's an opportunity for folks to ask questions. If you would like, you can. We'd ask you to use the chat feature so everyone can see the question rather than the Q&A feature. So if you put your questions in the chat, that would be the most helpful. I will try to answer the questions as best I can, if I can directly, but if there's someone else on our panel that can answer them better, I will just ask that person to participate. And if you have a question you want to direct to someone, that's perfectly fine. So let's begin. All right, so our first question is there any way to study for the entrance exam? Our entrance test is not one of the national standardized tests for secondary schools. We are using the SSAT this year because of the pandemic. It's not normally the instrument that we use. We normally have our own instrument that's a combination of assessments that doesn't require any advanced preparation. So I wouldn't say, oh, you can just go out and buy one of the SSAT books or get tutoring for it. We don't find that that's all that helpful or necessary. So long as you're applying yourself in sixth grade or in ninth grade, or in eighth grade, you're going to be doing what's necessary to be successful on the test. So I don't think there's anything extraordinary you need to do for our test. If you choose to use the SSAT as the test you want to submit, there are test books out there for the SSAT, and you might want to consult one of them if that's the test you're going to submit for your admissions application. Okay, next question. Acceptance rate for ninth graders. It varies from year to year. Last year, it was about 46%. So it depends on the number of applications that we get from year to year. I've seen it as low as 35%. I've seen it as high as 52 or 53%. So it can go up and down. Remember, our ninth grade has 36 students coming up already from our eighth grade. So we're only looking to fill about 104 spots. So obviously we accept more students because not everyone is going to come. So that number varies from year to year. Okay, so the next question is, how many recommendations do you need? Dr. Donovan, maybe you could address that question.
In terms of recommendations, we require that a English teacher, a math teacher, and a guidance counselor or principal write a recommendation. The guidance counselor principal is really about disciplinary and attendance issues, not that they know the applicant personally. The math and English teacher can be from this year or last year, whoever knows the student better. And then finally, there's an optional co-curricular recommendation, maybe for your parish priest, your Boy Scout leader, or your coach can do that.
And then there's a couple of questions about entrance testing. As I said, we are accepting some of the national tests as options. Dr. Donovan, are we accepting the ISEE?
We are accepting both the ISEE and the SSAT, but you must take those either at the test centers or at their at-home administration and send those to us. We are not involved in the registration or the acquiring of that. You need to do that and send those to us. Or you can take our in-person test, as we had mentioned, and directions are online for that.
So for homeschool students, we do have homeschool students who apply. Dr. Donovan, is there anything unusual for homeschool applicants that they need to do differently?
No, we have students from a whole variety of backgrounds, right? Charter school kids, private school kids, public school kids. So we would ask that you abide by our process. You know, you complete our admission test, you do our interview, you do our application. In terms of teacher recommendations, if it is you, you can do those assessment or those recommendations, but we do ask that you give supplemental recommendations that can attest to the recommendations that you're giving. So the more what we call it intersubjective verifiability, the verifiability of other people who will attest to your testament to your son, that would be helpful.
Thank you. Okay, any other questions? And feel free to ask questions beyond just the admissions process. You can ask any question about anything at Del Barton. So next question is, how would you describe your model Del Barton student? How is student progress typically measured? Well, I think if you look at Zeke or Matt, those are great examples of what a Del Barton student is like. That's why we asked them to be with us tonight. But they're very different. They have different interests. They are involved in different things. They've both been lifers, but that's, in many ways, that's one of the key things they have in common. But just listening to them, you've heard how very different their paths have been here at Del Barton. So I don't think we have a type. I think we want students who are hardworking, who are motivated to challenge themselves. We want students to be able to be open to that transformative experience on all of those four levels, spiritually, intellectually, emotionally, physically. We want people to be open to the impact that our program can have and take advantage of the opportunities when you're here. One thing we tell our students is not to be the guy who leaves at 2:40, right when school ends. Be someone who is involved. And you can see Zeke and Matt nodding their heads. They are happy, I think, because they've been involved, and they've been involved in many different things. Sometimes things at the, you know, now 2 years in or 6 years in or 5 1/4 years in, different things now than they were when they started. Preparing for the interview, there is no preparation needed. Just be yourself. As Mrs. Manahan said, it's very clear when students are overcoached in the interview. That's not helpful. It's really helpful just to be yourself. There's no need to do anything extraordinary or different. As far as how many teachers are Benedictines or brothers or priests, we have three monks who are full-time, including myself, and we have two monks that are part-time. We have another monk who is in training right now, who was a lay teacher actually, who will be returning to the faculty soon. So the vast majority of our teachers are lay teachers, which is pretty typical for Catholic schools these days. But the monastic community, even if they're not full-time teachers, a number of our monks who are retired or semi-retired assist with retreats as confessors. We celebrate Mass every day in the school chapel. We offer confession once a week, as well as on our retreat program. So we have a number of ways that monks who are not even full-time on the staff can participate and engage in the life of the school. The dress code's fairly simple. It's a collared shirt, trousers, usually khaki pants. You can wear informal shoes or dress shoes, but you cannot wear boots or sandals or anything like that, belts and socks. So basically, it's not a jacket and tie. We only use that at the moment for special occasions. We ask our students to keep themselves well-groomed. As you can see, Zeke and Matt have like pretty typical haircuts for Del Barton students. We didn't ask them to do that. That's just kind of the way they are. So we do want our students to look neat and clean, but we don't mandate a specific length for their hair. We do have a number of clubs. We have multiple clubs for engineering and STEM. We are actually going to be doing some renovations in our science building to expand the space available for our robotics and engineering programs. That'll be happening next summer, be ready for September of 2021. So we have clubs and activities for engineering and STEM in the middle school as well as in the high school. Students in one class, well, there's two ways I guess I could take that. In a particular grade in the middle school, the grade is 36 kids in seventh, 36 kids in eighth. In 9 through 12 in the high school, the classes are around 140. In an individual section of a class, the average class size is about 14.7. So our classes are very small. We have classes sometimes as small as 5. The largest a class would be 18. So our classes are very small and our teachers only teach 4 sections. So the most a teacher could have would be 72 students. And most of our teachers have significantly fewer than that. So our program is designed and our staffing is designed to facilitate students knowing their teachers in a very close way and collaborating with their teachers very well. Typical night's workload, it varies somewhat, but usually students will have about 2 hours of homework a night. And that doesn't always mean written homework. For us, homework is review as well as assignments that are due the next night. If a student has a more advanced math class, which some freshmen might have, or advanced biology, for example, or advanced English, the workload might be a little higher. But I think a 2 hours a night on average is typical, but it can vary significantly depending on the time of year. So the question about what our students look like, Matt Durso is a graduate of the class of 1996. He is also our Dean of Guidance. And he shared our profile of a Delbarton graduate, sort of ideally what our students would be like when they graduate. So again, Zeke and Matt are just two individual examples of what a Delbarton student is like, but we have 630 other students who are special and different in their own way. Like I said, we don't have a type. I do think though, when you look at the profile of graduates, you'll have a sense of what we aspire for our students to be once they've gone through this transformative process. If there are more restrictions due to COVID and if the in-person December test is canceled, we will, as I said, we are accepting tests that can be taken online like the SSAT and the ISEE. Those national standardized tests for secondary schools are offering them that you can take them at home. So we can accept those as an option if the in-person test is not available. We don't anticipate that, but we are prepared for that. There is no minimum grade point average. Most grade schools or middle schools don't have grade point averages. We look at a student's total academic record. The vast majority of our students either have all A's or a mix of A's and B's, more A's than B's. I would say if a student has a grade mix like that, he's certainly in the ballpark, but we look at grades, we look at our entrance test and the interview. So we look at the total package. It's not an automatic where there's a cutoff of if you have one B or two Bs, we would not accept you. We don't use a hard and fast cutoff that way. Oh, okay. So about what's happening coming to Delbarton? Well, quite a few things, actually. So you saw in the video, construction, we are adding a 20,000 square foot addition to Trinity Hall. It's called St. Benedict Hall. It will contain a brand new library that'll be about 13,000 square feet. So almost double the space that we have now. Also a guidance center and some additional classrooms that will allow our guidance staff to collaborate and support one another and your sons in ways they never have before. We're planning to move into that building probably in late April and perhaps even earlier. They're making tremendous progress. We're in the final stages of a major curriculum overhaul that will provide, starting next fall, the opportunity to take music courses for credit during the school day. In addition, it will allow students a great deal more flexibility in their elective choices, particularly in junior and senior year, but to a lesser extent in sophomore year as well. In addition to our facilities, we are looking to break ground in March on a major enhancement to our stadium down at the north end of campus. When you first come in, we're looking to build a field house that will provide on-campus public facilities and locker and training facilities for seven different sports. 5 new tennis courts, a new set of bleachers, and to replace the track and the turf. That'll take about a year, and we would hope to have that completed by the start of the 2022-2023 school year. So there's quite a bit of important developments happening right now, even as we speak, as well as on the immediate horizon. For admissions, the interview and the test, it's a three-legged stool, grades, the interview, and the test. Each one counts the same. There's no, that's the same as it would be ordinarily. Whether the interview happens physically here on campus or virtually, that won't make any difference. It's not going to have any impact one way or the other. But every student will be interviewed and every student will have to submit test scores or sit for our test. Applying this year so far, we have in the seventh grade, I think we have about 60 students so far who've applied. In the ninth grade, I believe we have about 220 some, Dave, maybe more. If you give Dr. Donovan a minute, he can actually look up the exact number.
I'm going to look that up right now.
Okay, so I'll come back to that. Okay, for potential transfer students, we had 12 transfer students this year, about evenly split between 10th and 11th grade, students coming in as sophomores, students coming in as juniors. Sometimes it can be a bit of a challenge just if students are coming here because they're looking for a stronger challenge. And when they actually get here, the difference between their previous school and this school can be a little eye-opening just in terms of the workload. We take a great deal of care with our guidance staff in particular to monitor transfer students. We meet with them multiple times over the summer to get them placed in courses correctly. We provide support for them individually as well as in groups. Our transfer students have had very good experiences, and generally they adapt very quickly. They're very happy to be here. And overall, again, it's not usual. We might only have one or two a year. This past year, we had about a half a dozen in each grade. So it can vary dramatically from year to year, but it does happen. And we welcome students, if we have room, who want to be a part of this community and want to embrace who we are and want to make a contribution to the Dumbarton family.
Father Michael, we have, as of tonight, 57 applicants for seventh grade, 18% of all applicants, and 243 for ninth grade. That's 77% of all applicants. We have 9 applicants to eighth grade, 3 for 10th grade, and 3 for 11th right now. Transfer applicants usually come later in the year on a rolling basis. We begin considering them after February, the transfers to 8th, 10th, and 11th on a space available basis.
Right. As far as technology goes, we are a bring your own device school. So every student is required to bring a technological device, whether a laptop or an iPad or a tablet. The vast majority of students bring laptops to school or use laptops at school. For our seventh and eighth graders, we provide a school-issued Chromebook to help them get used to having that technology. So you don't have to buy one if you're in seventh or eighth grade. We use funds we get from the state. Zeke, maybe you want to talk about how you use your Chromebook or how that makes a difference for you?
Yeah, I mean, they're really the same as the MacBooks, but it's just like really good to kind of get your feet wet and like experience what's going to happen once you enter the upper school.
Right. So we do not issue, after we issue equipment in the seventh and eighth grade, starting in ninth grade, students bring their own. The vast majority of students have Apple products because that's what high school kids do. But you can bring Apple products, Dell products, whatever you want. Our network can handle both. A lot of what we do, certainly that was true during the virtual period back in the spring. We use a platform called Schoology, which is the tool that we use to help students organize their work as well as to do their work. A lot of tests and quizzes are given through Schoology. A number of discussion groups, chat rooms, discussion boards, all of that can happen. So we use that platform very widely in individual classes, even in in-person instruction. So technology is used quite a bit on an everyday basis here. We don't have a 504 plan committee and program. We do provide limited accommodations to students who have mild to moderate learning issues, but we are not able to handle students who need extensive 504 accommodations. As an independent school, we're not obligated to provide everything that a 504 plan might call for in a public school setting, but we do our best to provide the support that we can. But we have limited options given the advanced nature of our program. Perhaps percentage of students who are involved in athletics. Mr. Whalen, maybe if you could speak about that. Dan Whalen is our athletic director.
I was able to answer that 90% of our students participate in one interscholastic sport by the time they graduate. We have 16 varsity sports and many sports at four levels, middle school, freshman, JV, and varsity. But many people participate and many of our sports have no cuts.
Great. Thank you. So we do have a number of options for people who are interested in theater production, stage crew, sound and light technician work. All of the options in production are available for students. We have a full-time theater technical director who has worked professionally in theater, and he trains students in how to use the light board, how to do sound, how to build sets. So if theater production is something you're interested in, we rely on students to make that happen. So you can get as involved in that and learn as much as you wish. For APs, we offer 26 different AP courses in all disciplines. So we don't offer every AP course, but we offer a wide range of them. We have one of the largest AP programs in the state of New Jersey. And students can begin taking AP courses, usually with very rare exceptions. It starts in sophomore year, and as a part of our curriculum review and curriculum reform, we're going to provide students even more opportunities to take like multiple languages or multiple science, advanced AP science courses when they're juniors or seniors. So Zeke, you're being asked to talk about how you interact with the folks in the upper school.
Yeah. So one of the great things about Del Barton is if you ever have a question or you want like an explanation of something, you can always anytime email or call one of your middle school mentors and they'll explain it to you and give you and help you with it basically. And we have constant contact with them basically like usually once a month, but that time it's different on like how many questions you have or whatever.
Right. Thank you. Sports with freshman teams, let's see, soccer, football, basketball, baseball, lacrosse, a number of teams have like large JV squads, like hockey only has two teams because the number of students who play JV and varsity. But those teams are the ones that have specific teams for ninth graders, but ninth graders they don't have a special team for ninth graders. Ninth graders are able to try out for teams like wrestling, for example, or track and field or cross country. As far as testing, yes, you can. Dr. Donovan, I just want to confirm with you, if a student comes for the in-person interview and tour, can they still do the testing remotely or use the SSAT or ISEE?
So we are asking that people choose either one track or another from the beginning and stay with that track because it gets very confusing if people jump test virtually, but interview in person, it gets difficulty. The only exception is that if you chose an in-person track and you have to be quarantined or fall ill, or there's somebody in your family that has developed a situation, you contact us and we can absolutely jump you to the virtual track. So to answer your question, we would ask that you take our test if you were doing everything else in person, unless there's a special circumstance.
Thank you. The acceptance rate for students from seventh grade, again, it depends on the number of applications. So we look for 36 students, that's the maximum for seventh grade. So it can range from 35, 40% to well over 50%, depends on how many students we get in a given year. Percentage of students that are accepted from public schools, about 2/3 of our applicants are from public schools and about 1/3 are from Catholic elementary schools or private schools. So now directly translatable into 2/3 of our applicants from public, our applicants are accepted from public schools and 1/3 from private schools. So the majority though, and again, it varies from year to year, depending on the particular applicant pool, but the significant majority of our applicants come from public schools and a majority of our students, or close to 50-50 depending on a given year, are a split between Catholic and other independent schools and public schools?
80% of our students happen to be Catholic, 20% are not Catholic, and about 24% of our student body self-identify as non-white. Just give you an idea of the demographic of the student body.
Right. Exams, right now, exams are worth 1/7. Well, we give exams only at the end of the academic year for full year courses. And so exams are worth 1/7 of the final grade. So 6/7 are based on the grades over the course of the three trimesters, and then the exam is worth 1/7 of the final grade. Middle school transfer applicants, they're pretty rare. It's only if we have a seat available. Like right now, all the seats in the middle school are full. And we, unless students move away, we generally don't lose students from 7th to 8th grade. So it's quite possible that next year, even though we have people applying for 8th grade, there just won't be any seats. So we do accept students in the 8th grade, but only if there's a seat available. So it could be 2 or 3 years in between times when we accept an 8th grader and the next time we accept an 8th grader. Community service. So community service is across the school, 7 through 12. We don't have a community service requirement, but almost 100% of our students participate in one or more community service activities over the course of the year, whether it's a major drive or a particular program. Like with right now, it's very difficult to do because of the pandemic, but we do tutoring at Neighborhood House. We help out at the community soup kitchen or the community food bank. A number of other food banks or after-school programs. We work with handicapped students through a program called EPIC at the Madison Y. So we have a wide variety of programs. Unfortunately, a lot of them are not running right now because they're not accepting volunteers because of the pandemic. But it's almost 100% year in, year out. So admitted to 9th grade, so we'll probably admit about 135 to get the 140 that we want. Because again, we have 36 students coming up from the 8th grade. So yes, if you want to learn more about meeting teachers and coaches, you're able to do that to a certain extent in person when you come for the interview. Dr. Donovan, maybe you could talk about if people want to learn more from a coach or a teacher, how they can do that.
Yeah, I also made a response to that in the chat. One of the great things we have, we really in this time of COVID tried to give a lot of assets and tools online. So Del Barton 360 is a fabulous online platform. If you log on, you'll be able to communicate directly with not only members of our school community, teachers or coaches, but also kids and through PeerPal, other parents. But if you are coming on campus for an interview, reach out, even if you're not, just reach out to a teacher and coach. They will get back to you. And depending on their schedule or comfort level with the COVID protocols, they can talk to you about the possibility of connecting or even meeting. So for instance, we had this past Saturday, a specific day for, there were football players who were interested in our football program and our coach met with them. We have guidance counselors here also and other teachers who are part of our admission committee that would be happy to speak to you on Saturday mornings if you're interviewing on a Saturday morning. So just reach out to us. There are many resources available online for that.
Okay, so one good question is about opportunities for athletes to participate in the arts. As I said, we're going to be adding music to the academic day. It's the last arts program we have that doesn't that meets after school as an activity, not as a curricular program. Our visual arts courses are part of the academic day. Theater is by its very nature something that happens after school as you rehearse for productions. So depending on the season that a student plays a sport, we offer theater all three seasons, fall, winter, spring. So we have a number of athletes who play a fall sport or a spring sport and who do the musical or who will do the one act festival in the spring or who'll do the fall drama. So by adding music to the school day and providing more room for that, we're going to increase our opportunity for students to do that. But also, since they happen all year long, students can look to mesh when they're not in season to particularly something like theater when they want to participate in. If it's visual art like painting or sculpture, those are academic courses during the day. Diversity and inclusion. We have, as Matt pointed out, we have a very active student program called Diversity Among Peers that provides an opportunity for social events, but also for education for the entire student body. They develop and produce workshops each year that deal with diversity issues that the student body experiences all throughout the year, not just any one particular time. As Dr. Donovan pointed out, about a quarter of our student body identifies themselves as non-white in a variety of ways. So particularly in our theology program, one of the courses all students have to take is a course in Catholic social teaching and social justice. So social justice issues are not something that we do because it's popular at the moment. It's something that is deeply embedded in our identity as a Benedictine Catholic school. So understanding issues of social justice, how to respond to them, particularly in the framework of Catholic social teaching. All students take that course, whether they're Catholic or not. Our religion program is required for all students. And so all students have that experience in the 10th grade. We also do social justice workshops, particularly for 9th graders twice a year in the fall and in the spring. College counseling, great, that's a great question. College counseling begins in earnest in the sophomore year, where we provide a lot of opportunities for parents as well as students to begin learning about the college process. It deepens, so there's an introductory meeting for parents in the sophomore year. We have a printed guide that we share with you that gives you a detailed roadmap for how our college process works. As I said, in our new building, we're having part of the building on the second floor is a new guidance center that will have a brand new center for college counseling, where we now are able to have 4 college counselors for the senior class. So the ratio of students to counselor is about 33 per counselor, which is, I think, an outstanding ratio. Lots of individual attention. You'll meet multiple times with your counselor starting in the spring of junior year as you transition from Mrs. Gleason, who's our junior counselor, to your college counselor. But there are specific programs in place for sophomore parents as well as for junior parents and students to learn about how college placement works. And we also provide, at no extra cost, in-school SAT prep and ACT prep. So we provide multiple opportunities in the evenings or on weekends for students to get SAT or ACT prep taught by our own teachers. It's a multiple hour course. It's at no extra cost to you. That's just a part of the program that we offer. And we also enable students to take the SAT and the ACT in school on a school day here at Delbarton, which makes it easier, particularly when students have lots of commitments on the weekends. We have multiple tools and support structures in place for parents as well as for students to navigate through the college process. We do not offer merit scholarships. Our financial aid is only need-based. We do not offer merit scholarships. Yes, you are encouraged to play multiple sports. Multi-sport athletes are our most successful athletes. They avoid overuse injuries. So yes, you can play multiple sports. You can play as many sports as you wish, so long as you're able to fulfill the commitments to them. We have a number of 3-sport athletes. And we do offer mass every day. We have mass in the morning. I usually offer the school mass at 7:40. Parents are welcome as well. We have staff members, students who come. We offer confessions once a week, and then every student participates in a retreat each year that they're here. Okay, and I notice in the chat, there are a number of more specific answers from Mike Rosenhaus, for example, who's our director of college counseling. So I'm trying to give an overview answer, but there are also some more detailed answers. So please look for those as well. The school day starts at 8:10 and ends at 2:40. Our buses come at 4 o'clock, and we have a late bus at 6 that you can pay extra for to get a bus pass for. So our school day does not start as early as other high schools in the area, which I think is a really good idea. Okay. Yes, we do not have midterm exams. Middle schoolers do take final exams. A question about, is your leadership team diverse? We have a leadership team of about 9 people. Our diversity and inclusion coordinators are a part of our leadership team. They participate in the administrative team here at school. They're both teachers, but they're also people, Jenna Gomez and Tony Negrin. They are both our diversity and inclusion coordinators, and they are a part of the administrative team as well. So we have men and women, we have people of a variety of ethnic backgrounds who are a part of our leadership team. So our retreats take place all year long. For middle schoolers and seniors, it's a full day of recollection. Normally in a normal school year, our freshman, sophomore, and junior retreats are overnights, one of which is the freshman retreat is here on campus in our retreat center. And the sophomore retreat, which is linked to the social justice course, is an urban immersion program at the Romero Center down in Camden. And then the junior retreat is a Kairos retreat. It's an intensive Curcio style retreat that's 3 days long. It's during the school week. So we carve out time for that because we believe very much so that you give time to what's important. And so taking that time away for that retreat experience, which are all student led with adult participation as well. We think that makes for the most effective retreat experience.
Father Michael, I hear one question. I'm not sure if you answered it. I apologize, I missed it. I'm not sure it's answered in the chat. How does Benedictine philosophy or approach work its way into the classroom?
Well, that's a great question. So there's a document on our webpage, if it's in the section called About, it's called The Hallmarks of a Benedictine School. It's a document that it was developed a number of years ago and we adapted it for our own use. It's a way to see how 10 key elements of what it means to be a Benedictine school, how they translate themselves into the day-to-day life of a school. So I'll give you an example. So the first of those hallmarks is love of God and neighbor. So that in every administrative decision, in the relationships that teachers have with students, we look to, as we make those decisions or as we have those relationships, we ask ourselves, are we choosing a school policy, changing a school policy, implementing a policy, having a conversation with a student in a way that fosters their love of God and their love of neighbor? And everything about the school needs to direct students and staff to that end. So if you have a chance, if you go to our webpage and go to the About section under Mission, you'll see a link to that. And it's a document, it has a few pages long, it's not terribly long, but it provides a great description of how exactly in concrete terms, how a particularly Benedictine Catholic school has that flavor and how it expresses itself in the day-to-day life of the school. We are in person. So we are here in person each day and we have been since the beginning of the year. We do not have a rowing program. So yes, the monastic community offers, we have a Sunday mass at 11 o'clock. We're not a parish, but we do have a regular group of congregants that come to us every Sunday. So quite a few of our students and families come for Sunday mass here at the Abbey Church, and that's every Sunday at 11. And we also offer mass at Thanksgiving, Christmas, other key days of the year where people are welcome to come and pray with the monks every day. We have mass every day for the monastic community at 5 p.m. in the Abbey Church. Even now, even with COVID, people are able to come. We have a regular group of folks who come. So if you're ever interested in coming to pray with us, you can find our prayer schedule on the school website and on the Abbey website at stmarysabbey.org. We do not offer athletic scholarships. Okay. So good question. Middle schoolers, they share the same building. They eat the same lunch. They navigate the hallways the same way as everybody else. So no, we do not have a separate middle school building. They are very much integrated into the day-to-day life and the day-to-day flow of the student body. So the question about how do Benedictine schools differ from Jesuit ones, that is a question that could take me several days to try to answer. I think the best way to describe it is you're going to find a fair amount of overlap. All good Catholic schools run by religious communities, whether it's the Society of Jesus or Benedictines, are going to have a lot of the same qualities because they're all Catholic schools. But there are particular things that are expressive of the charism of St. Ignatius of Loyola, and there are other things about us that are characteristic of the rule of Benedict that, again, if you look to that document, the hallmarks of a Benedictine school, you'll get a good sense of who we are and how that expresses itself in our day-to-day life. And I think if you start there and then look to a school like St. Peter's, for example, you can then have a basis for comparison. But it would take me far too long to try to answer that at the moment. Mr. Negrin, actually, that's a great point. If you want to learn more about our commitment to diversity, equity, and inclusion and what we do on a daily basis and an annual basis, we have a kind of a microsite that tells you all about our efforts for diversity and inclusion. That's a great question. How easy is it for non-Catholics to integrate? As I said, we're very clear about the fact that we're a Catholic school. Students who come, if you choose to come to Dalbarton, you do take a theology course, you do participate in retreats, we do worship together, but it's very important to us that all students feel welcome. And we like to say that we evangelize, we provide students with an experience of what it means to pray in the Catholic tradition and to worship in the Catholic tradition and to understand the Catholic tradition from an academic and theological point of view. But then our goal is for each student, no matter what his faith background is, for each student, as I said at the beginning, to develop a deeper relationship with God, whatever his or his faith tradition is, and for that relationship with God and his own personal faith to transition from the faith of a child to the faith of a young man. So our student body president last year was non-Catholic, was not Christian. We have students who are leaders in our retreat program who are not necessarily Catholic. I think you'll find that when you're here, it's a very Catholic place, but a good Catholic school is a school that welcomes whoever chooses to be a part of it. All right. I think that may be all the questions we have. So the acceptance process would happen in January. So all the notifications are electronic and you'll be notified. If you apply for financial aid, you'll also get a notice of your financial aid award along with your acceptance. We need students to respond back to us by early February, and the timetable for responding and putting a deposit down will be indicated in your admission material. So you'll also get, if you're admitted, you'll also get something in the mail in addition to the electronic notification, but all students are notified at the same time through school admin, the platform you use to apply.
Father Michael, I see one question. Maybe we can turn it over to Zeke and Matt to get our student perspective. It says, can they reflect on their experience at Dalbarton, favorite part of the school day, and what stood out to them in their decision to join Dalbarton? I don't know if Matt or Zeke want to comment on that.
So why'd you choose us? I guess that's the best way to put it.
On to favorite part of the school day. I really don't have one. I mean, everything's different and everything is just, I love it. the school is great. And I came here because really it's you, there's such so many choices to make. In a way, I play football and hockey, and it's like an all-inclusive school where you can really do anything.
Matt?
Yeah, going off of what Zeke just said, there's a variety of things to do here and to participate in. For me, the biggest aspect and differentiator for me was the community. You're going to have the academics, you're going to have the athletics, you're going to have all the other extracurriculars, but the community, the people who are here with me, I'm on a day-to-day basis. It's been awesome. And I'm excited that I chose Dumbarton, and this has been my home for going on 6 years now.
Great. Thank you. So David, have we come to the end of our time or?
I believe we have. I want to thank everybody for attending. Certainly you're going to have questions as you move forward. It does not end here. Our engagement and experience and interaction with you does not end here. We like to think we're an open and ecumenical community that really kind of reaches out to our community, and we want you to get to know us. I think that makes the best opportunity for a good match moving forward. Take advantage of our resources online, Dumbarton 360, the U-Visit Tour, and certainly contact us if we can help you with further questions. All of this will be available online after this event in the future too. Okay?
Great. Thank you, Dr. Donovan. Thank you to all of our panelists, and thank you for joining us. We're very excited that you were able to be a part of this. We wish we had seen you in person, and we hope to see you on campus for interviews. And again, as Dr. Donovan said, the recording of our live sessions and the content of this open house are available on Dumbarton 360 for you or somebody you might know to be able to explore at your convenience. Use Dumbarton 360 and our U-Visit 360 virtual tour. If you haven't been here before, haven't had a chance to visit campus, that's a great way to get that feel. I mean, as Dr. Donovan said at the beginning, when you come for your interview as a part of admissions, you will get an in-person tour. Matt Johnson is the leader of our student ambassadors program, so you might see him or one of his colleagues showing you around and giving you a sense of what we're all about. So again, thanks a lot for being with us, and we're always here to talk to you in case you have any questions.